It's like, if you're not a multi-millionaire, I'm not taking advice from you. I mean, just pure and simple. I mean, that's what I'm looking for, people that I want to. So if somebody has a great physique or great health and stuff like that, I mean, like, I want to learn from them. I want to get better all the time.
Hey, babes, it's Cayla Craft with the Mommy Millionaire Podcast. I'm a mom of three littles, ER nurse turned self-made millionaire, and lifestyle entrepreneur. I am bringing you inspiring stories, business and mindset tips to help you be shameless in pursuing your ambitions. Hey, Mommy Millionaires, welcome to the show. I am so excited to have Daniel Alonzo on today because he's pretty much like amazing and he's a legend. And so we are so blessed to have him on the show today. So welcome, Daniel, to the show.
I'm so excited. I don't know about a legend, but you know, I'm super, super excited to be here with you. Thank you so much.
You are a legend. Just own it. Just own it. So, okay, you have been in network marketing for a really long time, and there's a lot of people listening in right now that 50% of them are network marketers. The other 50% are people that still, you know, they don't really know if it's a legitimate business. Like it's questionable. They don't think people in network marketing are real entrepreneurs. So I thought, let's just start it off with that controversial topic. What do you say to people that say that?
Well, I just say that it's really unfortunate that people are missing out on some of the greatest opportunities in the world. Because I mean, think about this for a second. I mean, I started at 21 years old. I had no money. I was making $7 an hour. What company in the world? I was not a college graduate. What company in the world was going to, after, I don't know, 3 years or something like that, was going to pay me $100,000 a year? And then on top of that, like give me $100,000 pay raises every single year. And on top of all that, teach me how to save $1 million in cash by the time I was 28. So look, I don't know about you, but I think it's pretty real.
Me too. Me too. I love that. And I see, like, when you speak, there's so much conviction in your voice. So like, I think if more people could hear from you, and I think people feel the same way when they hear me speak too, how do people get that type of conviction? Because I think that's why most people don't believe in it, because maybe they've tried it in the past and it didn't work in the first week. So they quit. You know, there's a lot of quitters out there. And it's because they didn't really believe in it. They didn't have that conviction in their voice. And how did you develop that?
The first thing I did was I went out and I read every book. I'm in the financial business. So I read every book on financial services, okay, insurances, investments. I studied my ass off so that I could get the conviction, because I believe that competence breeds the confidence. And so very, very confident about what I do, because I know what I do is right. And of course, you know, through the years, just with pure experience, I've seen it impact so many people's lives throughout all these years. And so, of course, my level of conviction is through the roof. I mean, I think the last time I checked, my organization has paid out, I mean, just my little team, you know, that I've built through the years, we've paid out over $103 million in death claims. And we have over $200 million in assets under management. And so we've, you know, set up retirement funds and college funds and all these. I mean, so it's like when you impact that many people, it's like, give me a break, man. I mean, I'm like, I believe in what I'm doing because I've seen it.
Oh my gosh. I love that. I love that. So competence breeds confidence. I 100% agree with that, because when I got started in health and wellness, that's exactly what I did. I was like, okay, I'm going to become a health coach. So I got a certification in that, and that wasn't required to build the business. But the more I learned about health, I was like, oh yeah, everybody needs to eat these things that I'm selling. Right. So I love that. I love that tip. So a lot of you guys think, and I think, I don't know if they do this in your company, you know, or other network marketing events you've gone to, but they kind of like, they want to make it sound like it's easy. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, where it's kind of like, all you have to do is X, Y, and Z. And I'm like, well, no, that's not really all you have to do. Like, you should want to become an expert. Like, you should want to have a level of excellence in your life. Do you hear that often?
I mean, you know, come on. Easy is sleazy. I mean, you know, come on. I think, honestly, I mean, I've been in business for now 23 years, and I believe that I'm still in business after all of these, because, you know, I've seen people come and go. I've even actually seen people that were successful at one time that are no longer in the company anymore. And so to me, I really honestly believe that the reason why I'm still around going strong, okay, 45 locations, 1,500 licensed agents with the state, with all the states that we're in. And I believe we're going strong because I tell it like it is. I've always been one of those people, like when I'm giving a big event or I'm, you know, selling people on coming into business with me, I always tell people the truth. Like, look, you know, this is not a get rich quick scheme. If you're looking for a get rich quick scheme, this is the wrong deal. And I think I probably recruited, I mean, you know, I probably recruited less people maybe that I could have, but I believe that I built my whole philosophy around truth and honesty and doing the right thing and ultimately telling people the truth about, look, it's going to take hard work. You're going to have to be focused. You're going to have to learn shit you don't know right now. You're going to have to, you know, sacrifice, you know, eating with your family on Sunday night every once in a while. I mean, there's things that you're going to have to give up if you want to go up.
Mm. What has been the biggest, like, thing that you've had to give up to go up?
Well, I mean, I was 21 and I kind of gave up a little. I mean, I guess I would, you know, if you were to ask, I gave up my 20s, you know, and it was, I mean, I was hanging out. I was supposed to be at fraternity parties, which I didn't go to college, but I mean, I, you know, gave up lots of drinking and lots of partying and lots of probably traveling with friends and things like that. I gave that up in my 20s. I mean, I was just focused on, you know, working and mm-hmm. mastering my craft and becoming the best that I could be. And, but I'm so glad. I mean, I know I mean, looking back, it was a sacrifice. I think maybe going through it, it was kind of a sacrifice, but ultimately I look back and it was the greatest decision that I ever made in my life because I gave up a few years. And now think about it. Since I've been 28, I've been financially independent, Cayla. So, I mean, I've been free. For all of these years, I've gotten, you know, my kids are now 17 and 13. And so I've gotten to watch them get raised. I mean, I've been able to raise them. I've been able to be the dad to take them to the fair on Monday morning, you know, take them out of school and go, you know, and take them to the movies and the concerts and all the different, you know, fun things that we've been able to do through the years. And I don't know if I would have had a 9-to-5 job. I don't know that I would have been able to do a lot of the stuff that I've been able to do.
Mm, I love that. That's so exciting. You know, I think I was in the same boat as you. I gave up my 20s. Like literally it was like hardcore. And I think one of the things that bugged me the most when I was building was I felt kind of alone. Like, because all of my friends that like were friends, they didn't understand like my ambition. And they thought like, I was like the black sheep, even in my family. And that was really hard to feel so alone. Did you struggle with that at all?
I mean, I think we all do when you have a bigger dream than most people, because I've always had this dream of wanting to impact the world and make a difference and try, you know, and I have a heart for helping people. I really want to make a difference in people's lives. And so to me, you know, it is lonely because not everybody wants that. Nope. Not everybody cares about that. It doesn't really matter to people. People want to go to their job. They work and nothing wrong with that. If you want a job and you love the job that you're doing, you're a school teacher or something, you're like, I don't care about money. I don't care about financial freedom. I don't care about, I just want to teach kids. I mean, God bless you. That's a great thing. But for me, I'm playing me. You know, mm-hmm. I'm Daniel Alonzo. I'm playing my life, man. And so I knew what I wanted from a young age. I wanted financial freedom. I wanted to retire by the time I was 30. Now I changed that when I got to 30, but that was all I thought about. Mm-hmm. And that was me. That was me playing me. So I think that there's a lot of people, they struggle with that feeling of being alone, that they're different. And I say, embrace that, man. Mm-hmm. Who cares, man? I mean, you're not going to be like everybody else. If you don't want to be like everybody else, then be different. Then put yourself out there. Then take risks. Go for it. Try new things. The worst case scenario, you fail and you start over again.
So that
was my, but look, the feeling of loneliness, Cayla, we all feel that, man. Mm-hmm. Every one of us that make something big, we make a big goal, we all feel that feeling.
Yeah, I love that. See, I just got through it by having the F you mentality, which works too. So, yep. Okay, let's talk really quick, because now I'm like, I want to know how he got 1,500 agents in all these states. So what was your number one way to recruit people? And I know you're still doing it now. What's working now?
Let me just tell you. I mean, the way I really built my business from day one was recruiting and training. So, and recruiting all starts with prospecting. So you got to make a new friend. So I would go to my little brother's baseball practice and I would meet the parents, because I was 21. So I had no market. I didn't have, and again, I'm selling financial services. I'm selling insurance and investments. None of my friends that were 21 were ever going to need any of that crap. And so I had to put myself out there. I stole my mom's telephone book. Okay. We used to have like written telephone books back then. I stole it. It used to be in the kitchen up in the cupboard. I stole it, called everybody in the phone book. And I said, "Hey, I'm Carol's son. She wanted me to get together with you to show you what I'm doing." And then that's how I set up appointments in the beginning. And I mean, I won every Fast Start award in the beginning, and I was just on fire.
You're hungry.
And so I was hungry. I just wanted to be somebody. I wanted to do something great with my life. And I was tired of being sick and tired of being sick and tired. I mean, I had a $4,000 pickup truck that I drove around with no air conditioning in it. You know what I mean? And so I'm like, I don't want to live like this. Living in my mom's, basically her attic. I mean, it was a bedroom, but it was a converted, you know, attic into a bedroom. And it's like, no way. I'm not doing this, man. I am going to have a great life. And so prospecting all starts. And this is the question that I ask everybody is, I said, look, if there was a way for you to make an extra couple grand part-time, you ever keep your options open? or I would say something like, have you ever considered a career change if the money was right? And so that would kind of be my, you know, obviously I would say, what's your name? You know, how you doing? Do you live in the area? So a lot of the way I recruited in the beginning was through cold prospecting. I would prospect people because I didn't have anybody to really talk to. And then once I started getting into more homes and I started getting more clients, I would always ask them like, hey, have you ever considered a career change if the money was right? And then that would open it up for me to talk about doing the business. And then of course I recruited a lot of people across the kitchen table.
I love that. Does that still work today?
It does. I mean, when I have a client, I will ask that question if I'm across the kitchen table. But I just think, you know, today we're in a different world. I mean, you know, number one, I believe that people are in some situations are a little bit more skeptical today. And so I believe that branding is the wave of the future. I mean, I now have people reaching out to me. So I don't go to the malls and, you know, talk to cold strangers very often anymore. But
did do that in the beginning. I did that in the beginning too.
Oh, every day. I mean, my schedule was 9 to noon. I prospected every single day. 1 to 4, I would follow up with them. And then I would want to make sure that I was on a 6 o'clock and an 8 o'clock PM appointment every day. That was my goal. If I woke up in the morning and I didn't have an appointment, guess what I'd be doing all day? Trying to get on an appointment that night, some way, somehow, so that I can present my product. And so that was that's what I was after every single day.
I love that. Okay. So you're talking about how branding is the wave of the future. And so do you teach your new recruits that come in now, like, okay, we got to get you a personal brand?
Absolutely. I mean, matter of fact, I did a little training yesterday, and I was teaching them how to make the videos that I make on my Instagram. I mean, they're pretty simple. I mean, it's not a complicated thing how we put together some of these videos. But what I'm trying to do is add massive amounts of value. So I tell people, like, look, you don't, like, don't just post quotes of shit all day long. You know what I mean? Like, don't just recycle stuff that somebody else did. I mean, you go speak on camera. You go do your Instagram story and have a conversation with your audience. Mm-hmm. You build relationships just like you would build a relationship anywhere else. You build a relationship with your audience. And now it's like, it's phenomenal. I mean, people call me up like from all over the United States. I've recruited people in Georgia. I've recruited people in Texas, recruited people in Florida. I mean, Nevada, everywhere, all because they reach out now and they go, I want to be in business with that guy.
So I love that. So how are they seeing you all the way in Georgia? Are you using a certain hashtag, tagging yourself? Like, what's that strategy?
Well, I mean, that would not be my first goal to recruit somebody in Georgia, because I live in California. I'm in Southern California. So because my business is structured where I own a 5,000 square foot building in Ontario, California, and I have people come to my events and I teach them and I train them. I do training events every week. And of course we do opportunity events every week. And so I like people when they're close to me. So those people that caught me in different states, it's just that probably somebody shared my video with them or whatever. If I ever do like a sponsored ad, I always just do it for me personally. This is not for everybody, but I just do it in a surrounding area. Mm-hmm. And that's how I've been, because I would rather recruit somebody directly to me where I can be face to face with them eventually. And mm-hmm. I can teach them and take them under my wing personally and help them succeed.
I love that. Okay. So your philosophy is to grow local.
Correct.
I think that's so smart, because a lot of people, they like want to go international right away. And it's like, if you can't recruit people in your, like your next door neighbors, how do you think you're going to get people in Switzerland? Like, come on.
Totally.
Okay. I love that. I'm like, I get so excited when people make it sound so easy, because that's the exact way. I mean, it's easy it's not easy, I guess, but it's the concept sounds so simple. Like literally that's all you have to do in any type of business to be successful, is you should spend 80% of your time meeting new people and bringing people into the funnel. And a lot of people, they just don't have enough people in their funnel, right? And they're just focused on, I mean, I think they get too focused on the things that don't matter. Even though branding does matter, it's like they think the aesthetics of their Instagram really matter. I'm like, nobody really cares. Like, yep. Honestly, nobody really cares. Are you putting out good value? And the videos, I mean, that's the number one way people can get to know you right away. And how do you come up with so much good content? Because I'm like, I see your IGTV. I'm like, yes, Daniel. I love it. How can people get to that level?
Well, I think number one, I have a little bit of an advantage in the fact that I do training every week. So I'm training a group of 100, 200 people every single week at any given moment.
Well, you created that advantage for yourself, though.
I did. I did create the advantage. And by the way,
so anybody can do that. Anybody can.
Totally. But the advantage for me is the fact that I'm usually, because I make the most money in my organization, I'm usually the one speaking on stage. And so what I do is every time I'm on stage, I capture that content. And I think a lot of people out there, they're embarrassed to capture their content. And they don't take the time to set up the tripod, put up the camera, and videotape them on stage. So like, for example, and again, this is how anybody can create that advantage for them. Guess what you do? You go start winning. You go start having success. You go start inspiring the masses, do shit that people are excited about. And guess what's going to happen? People are going to put you on stage. People are going to get you on podcasts. People are going to get you out there. So it's like this podcast right now. We will take clips of this podcast and we'll send it out to the universe. Why? Because we captured this content right now. So what I'm telling everybody is, if you're ever on stage, if you ever have an opportunity to speak in front of a group of people, always capture that content. Mm-hmm. Video the crap, man. Don't just get up on stage. You miss that opportunity to share that wisdom, to share that value with the entire world.
I love that. I truly believe that like we're in a day and age where if you want to go big as an entrepreneur, like especially online, you need to have a videographer on staff, like with you at all times, just to get stuff. I've been working with a team that comes, I mean, we work with the same people, but I don't know if we have the same video team, but they come and I'm just like, this is the best thing ever. Cause they'll just ask me questions while I'm like doing my day. And I'm like, here, boom. And then we get content. And it's been amazing because it's, you realize like I already have so much stuff inside of me. And before I thought, gosh, it's so hard to create new content all the time. And now it's like, I don't know. I feel like I'm on a roll, on fire with it. And what do you say to those people that don't really have anything interesting to say? Like maybe they're not in network marketing. Maybe they're just, I don't know, a school teacher trying to create a brand.
Well, one of the things that I'm always doing is I'm always, when I watch a video or if I'm on Instagram or if I do see a really cool quote, a lot of times I'll screenshot it. And so that way I can have that conversation later on. And it might be a 2 or 3 or 5 minute video that I have a conversation on that one item. Because when we see a quote and it resonates with our soul, mm-hmm. we can go back and we can talk about that. Like, why did that quote resonate with my soul? And I can have that conversation and there's another piece of content. So, I mean, think about it. It's like endless amounts of things that resonate. I mean, think about how many times we click like every single day when we're going through our feed. And so it's never ending stuff to talk about. And all of us have our own opinion. All of us care about different things. So why not tell the world what your damn opinion is? You know what I mean? What do you like? Why do you love that? You know, why did you click like on that video? Why did you click like on that picture? And then take that idea. You don't have to, you know, say the quote, but you can just talk about the idea. You know why I believe this is true? You know why I think this is awesome? And then it's like, you got thousands, millions of things, topics that you can talk about every single day.
Okay. Such a great tip. I love that. I honestly, I do the same thing, but I'll go into the voice recorder on my phone and just like rant on something. On it. I'll be like, I saw this and blah, or like this just happened, blah. And then you have so much stuff you can go back on, or like maybe the thought needs to be thought out more and you could just journal about it and really come to your own opinion. So I absolutely love that. And they say, what is that quote that they say, if you want to be universally liked, sell ice, don't be a leader, sell ice cream or something like that.
Okay. Yes. Yes. Well, yeah. If you just want to be liked by everybody, okay. Then just sell. No. I actually used that one time. I did a video on that. I did mention that. But yeah, I mean, and because I'm a tough leader. So I like that quote because I am a tough leader. Like I'm a no nonsense, no bullshit. Like I will tell you directly what I feel. And so, because if you just want to be liked all the time, I mean, go sell ice cream,
right?
You know, go sell toys. They'll
you
all
said
like
it better.
But yeah. You know, but it's like I want to be a leader. I would rather you respect me than like me.
Yes, yes. So many people want to be liked. I just did an Insta story on this because I went to my daughter's school and it was her birthday. And so we're like passing out donuts and all the girls are just so like, they care so much about what the other little girls think. They're all 6 and 7, you know? And I thought, well, there's still 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds that still are doing that same thing, like caring so much. Oh my God, this person unfollowed me. Oh my gosh, like my life is over. I'm like, who freaking cares? Like who cares? So I think it's so, I think it's interesting. So I went on a rant on my story.
I got to tell you, Cayla, I mean, I really like you a lot. I mean, I think you are amazing because it's just funny that, because like I did a story on that. I don't know how
you
long
you did.
Ago, yeah. Like I did a story on that night because I was dropping my kids off to school. And you know what it was? Why I talked about it is because I don't know. I just being around people for 20 something years. I mean, I can read people.
Right.
Like I almost know what people are thinking before they're even thinking it. That it's kind of like a weird thing. And I was dropping my kids off and I'm looking at these little teenager kids, you know, elementary school teenager kids. And there's so much insecurity. There's so much lack of confidence. They're so just scared and just worried about what other people think about them all day long, every day. And I just think it's like, we got to crush that shit, man. I'm trying to crush it out of my kids.
Yeah.
And I think I've done an okay job, but it's just, it's almost like we're born with that, you know?
Well, it's true. Like they've done studies that you are with, I mean, like it's your genetics, you know, and you have to learn to break the cycle and change your whole biology, which you can do. I mean, Dr. Joe Dispenza talks about that. Are you familiar with his work?
No.
Oh my gosh. Okay. You have to have your team read, it's called Breaking the Habit of Being Yourself by Dr. Joe Dispenza. So good. So good. I wish I would have had it in the beginning of network marketing just because it could have helped so much. But I have this thing just popped up. I'm like, I got to ask him. I have this saying that I say, it's easier to give birth than to raise the dead. You know, go out there and get new customers instead of like trying to like make these people that don't really want it, want it. And I know you have to deal with that. So many people, they're like, gosh, you know, I thought this girl was going to be a really great recruit. And then, you know, she ghosted me. Okay, bye. Like on to the next. What do you say to that?
Well, I mean, it's just next. I mean, if I walk down a row and I offer different people coffee, you know, some people are going to want the coffee and some people aren't, but what am I going to do? Like argue with them?
Right.
Like, no, take the coffee. You really like coffee. No, you can't do that. Just like, look, you want coffee? No. Next.
You're not taking it personal. It's like, whatever.
No. Like think about a waitress that's serving food all day long. Like they don't take it personal that you didn't want to buy that special on, because they say, hey, we got a special today.
Right.
And they tell you about it. And most people say, ah, nah, I want my regular stuff or whatever. That's okay. People sometimes just want a regular life. That's okay. It's all right. It's not a problem.
You can't shame them for wanting to be okay, you know, wanting to be average. It's okay.
That's it. Yeah. I mean, you want to be average, good deal. So don't ever take it personal. When somebody quits on me, I always, you know, bless them. You know, God bless you, man. Keep rocking. I wish you the best. And no matter what you decide to do. And by the way, there's been some people that have left my business, gone on to doing other businesses and are super, super successful to, you know, to this day. I'd rather just bless them and, you know, hey, good luck to you in the future versus kind of getting upset and feeling bad about them leaving.
I love that. How did you get to that though? Because I feel like so many people, they get stuck, right? They're just like, oh, I'm trying to not take it personal, but I can't help it. I can't help it. Me, I grew up kind of having that because of my childhood. It was very easy for me to cut people off, you know, like I'm just like, bye. Like, cause that was my defense mechanism. So what did you do specifically? Cause I know that defense mechanism doesn't work for most people.
Number one, Cayla, when I first started in business, I wrote down 150 things that I wanted to accomplish in my life. So it was my goal list.
Okay.
So these were things that it was up on my wall. Mm-hmm. And I looked at it every single day of my life. Okay. And so if you don't want to win with me, I got shit I got to do.
Right.
Like I had a sense of urgency to try to become successful. I didn't know if I was going to be good enough. I didn't know if it was going to work. There was no guarantee. Nothing was going to happen. But guess what? I was on a mission to try to win. Now, come on. Did I get let down? Did I feel bad? Did I get hurt? Hell yeah. Did I get upset if somebody quit? Of course. I mean, we're human beings, man. I have emotions too. I get sad when, you know, you build a really great relationship with somebody and they say, and then they ghost you or whatever. And you're like, dude, like, I thought we were friends. I mean, at least you could call me up and say I quit or whatever. I mean, but so even though I went through that, my goals were so strong. My why was so strong that it was very hard for me to allow that person to infect me so much for me to quit. Because I kept telling myself all the time, if I quit, I'll never get to those 150 things. If I don't continue on, those 150 things are just wishes. They'll never happen. And I'm going to die with massive amounts of regret. And that is not going to happen. I cannot allow that to happen.
You just really trained your mind. I loved how you said you weren't going to let that person infect you. And that's exactly what happens. People get infected. It's like a disease. Oh my gosh. Wow. That's good. That's good right there, Daniel. I'm going to take that one. We're going to talk about infection later. Okay. So let's switch gears here. Cause I want to know, okay, in 23 years, how long have you been married?
For 19.
Okay. So you started your business before you got married. Were you guys dating or like how, that would have been hard. I feel like to like come into this. Is she in the business too?
Yeah. So actually we met in high school. So we're high school sweethearts.
Okay. So she saw the evolving Daniel.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, so we were 16 years old and I joined the business 5 years later.
Okay.
So, and that was, you know, that was probably one of the hardest things that we went through was figuring out our roles and figuring out if we could really do this together. Cause she's not like me. She's complete opposite personality. She, you know, did not like the business in the beginning. Mm-hmm. I had this grand vision of like changing the world and I'm going to go do something killer. And she was like, no, you know, I'm 21. I just want us to stay home and watch a movie. You know what I mean? I'm like, you know, so it was like, it was hard. I mean, I always felt like it was like a, and of course, you know, we battled, man. I mean, we battled hardcore in the early days. I mean, first 6 months, first year was just a freaking battle. And I remember one day we were in my maroon Nissan Sentra. Okay. Which did have air conditioning. So
yay!
I was involved.
You were moving up.
So I was moving on up. And so, I locked the doors in the car and I said, look, you're either in or you're out. And I was like, I was about ready to throw away a 6 year relationship with somebody I dearly loved. And, you know, my only real girlfriend, you know, of my life. And I said, look, I said, you're either coming with me or you're going to leave now. Like, we're not doing this anymore. It felt like it was like a backpack full of boulders.
Oh my
gosh. I was carrying around and just to all the partners out there, if mm-hmm. you're not supportive, that's what you are. You know, why not put the wind in their sails instead yes. of being a backpack full of boulders that are holding them down, you know? So it's like every time I was like ready to, you know, do something great, it was like, oh, got to put that backpack on. And then it just weighed me down and it was horrible, you know? And so that's where I drew the line in the sand, you know? And I've done that a couple of times. I mean, I did that in my relationship. One of my best friends growing up, I drew the line in the sand and I'm like, dude, I mean, I said, look, and I told my friend, my best friend, I said, look, I said, you don't got to join me in business. You don't got to sell anything. You don't got to, you know, buy anything. Like, I'm not telling you, you got to do any of that crap. I said, I just want you to support me.
Right.
If you ain't going to support me, we're going to end it right here because I don't have time. You know, I got a goal. I'm trying to get somewhere. I'm trying to do something with my life. Like, I don't have time for somebody that's trying to stop me.
Mm-hmm.
The goal is hard enough, for God's right. sakes, right? For me to now allow these people to, again, infect my thinking mm-hmm. and in my brain and to stop me and to slow me down. And it's like, you know, so that's, to me, you have to have that mindset. I believe if you're going to make it in anything in your life, trust me, I know a lot of successful people, we're all the same. We all had to go through that shit, but yeah. we rose above the masses. And we said, we are willing to give up, even if it's a relationship, so that we can go up.
Yeah. I think a lot of people struggle with that because they don't think that they're going to have to change in order to have the success that they want. And it's like sometimes changing means giving up a relationship. And there's a lot of women listening in right now that they have men that are not supportive, but they're actually married, right? So what do you say to those women? Because I know what I say. Like, I gave Chase an ultimatum. We were married for like 6 years at that point, and I said, it stops here. I can't do this. And he changed. But some women are not willing to do that. I am, because that's just me. But what do you say to, what would be your advice?
Get divorced right now. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. No, really though, I think it is for all of you women that are listening right now, if you have unsupportive spouses, man or woman, listen, you got to assess what you want in your life. The way I always look at it is I got one shot on this earth.
Right.
I got one life to live here, man. I'm just not going to waste it. I'm sorry. I don't want to waste it with somebody that's trying to hold me back. So like, look, you're either on board with me or you're not. Like, not in a bad way. I mean, I'm not trying to be mean. I'm not trying to be nasty. I'm not trying to cause divorces. I'm not trying to like say, I'm just saying that for God's sakes, we're adults already. Like if this is not what she would have wanted, then I loved her enough to say, look, if this is not the life that you want, if you don't want this life, if you don't want to go on this journey with me, then you got to go on your own journey. You know,
right.
Now, if she would have said to me, look, I got a better plan. I'm going to go and do this. Guess what I would have said? I would have said, right on. I'll support you on what you're doing. I'm going to support you on what you're doing. But at 21, she didn't have a better plan. Like, there was no fucking better plan. You know what I mean? It's like, dude, like, we're both came from not wealthy, you know, families or anything like that. And she had a really tough upbringing. And it's like, dude, like, we're 21 with the greatest opportunity sitting right in front of us. Like, let's run with this and let's go change our lives. And if you don't want that, then if you don't have another better idea, then you're either on board or you're not.
Right.
And that's the way we got to play this game. And, you know, so to all you women out there, you know, draw the line in the sand, but first know what you want, right?
Yeah.
Get your goals put down on paper and then decide that you're going to go to work no matter what, right? Whether they support you, they don't support you, you're going to go bust it no matter what to go get the shit done that you need to go get done. And that's my advice on that one.
I love that. I love it. Okay. So set boundaries. Just set your freaking boundaries. Okay. So are your kids, do they want to be entrepreneurs?
Not totally right now. Now my son, I think he'll end up going in the entertainment business or something like that. He's like super funny, but he's more on the introverted side. So a lot of actors, a lot of comedians, they're really great on stage, but they're a little more introverted on the home front. And that's my son. And so I'm going to support them in whatever they decide to do. My daughter, she's 13, she's a freaking killer soccer player. And so she'll probably want to go to college, which I'm not a big college fan, you know, like I'm not a big fan of college, but
yeah, me neither.
But if she wants to go to college, like to play sports or do something like that, dude, I'm good with that. Like, I love that. I want to support my kids. I've been able to, thank God, became financially independent. I'm, you know, mega, mega financially independent. So like, they can do whatever they want to do. I got enough money to do whatever they want, but that's how I set it up. That's why I did that, man. I want them to have options, total options. And so for some of you people out there that are not where you want to be right now, or you have young kids, you better get this shit done. Like, you better like go to work now and get it done, because like, your kids are getting older, and you want, when they get to that high school, college age, you want to be able to give them whatever options they, you know, can, you know, any options that they want.
Totally. And it's like, you sacrificed when your kids were, you know, I'm sure you're still sacrificing, but when your kids were really little, and there's a lot of moms that are listening in that their kids are really little and they use that as an excuse. I'm like, dude, that's the easiest time. Cause as they get older, they need you more. You have to be at everything. They realize when you're gone and you're traveling all over the world, right?
Totally. Totally.
And they don't want to go with you. They're like, I got a hockey tournament. So I think that's a really good point. It's like, work hard now, so that way you never have to tell them no later when it comes to building their life. I love that.
That is my wealth on the beach. I mean, honestly, that was my decision a long time ago that I wanted to be that dad. You know, that's why I take care of my body. You know, I take care of myself. I'm not like Mr. Universe or anything, but I take care of myself physically, drink a lot of water, eat a lot of greens, a lot of green drinks, stuff like that. You know why? Because I wanted to be the dad that when I took the kids to the fair, like, I wanted to get in the ride with them.
Yeah.
Okay. Like, I didn't want to be like 400 pounds, can't get in the dang, you know, like ride with them. So everything I like, there's a method to my madness, and everything I thought about, like how I wanted my life to look. And then I said, okay, what are the things that I need to do to create that life? And so when I was 28 years old, I went to lunch with one of my top guys, and I'm like, I made $500,000 the year before. And I had, you know, and it was mostly passive income. I mean, 99.9% passive income, residual income. And then at that time we, you know, we had saved $1 million. So for all intents and purposes at that moment, I was financially free. I called him up, said, took him to lunch. I'm like, dude, I'm out. Like I stopped going on appointments for like 10 years. For a long, long time. The only reason why I go on a few appointments now is just because people reach out to me, and now people want to be recruited by me and be trained by me and stuff like that. So I'm helping people now, but it was a long, long time that I wasn't in the field at all. But I set that up. If I want to go travel, I go travel for a month. If I want to, you know, sleep in bed all day long, I sleep in bed all day long. If I want to, you know, go to the spa today, I'll go to the spa. There's like nothing. I do whatever I want to do whenever I want to do it. And that's how I like it.
I love it. So have you been able to do all 150 things on your list?
Not yet. No. Some of them are income goals.
Okay.
So those are kind of in the making, but I'll tell you, I mean, I think I've probably wiped out a good 60 or 70% of everything on that list. Yeah.
That's so awesome. I love that. I love that. Okay. So we're coming to the end here, and I want to know from you how much, like, I know we talked about this when I was on your podcast, but you've had to invest a lot in yourself to get to where you want to go. So tell me, what are some of the types of things that you've invested in order to get to this level that you're on today? I mean, you speak on stages all over the world and you like rock it. Plus you've been able to just make this like amazing family. So I know you've had to do a lot of personal development and all that kind of stuff. So how much do you think you've spent and what have you spent it on?
Oh God. I mean, that's like, it would be hard to calculate, but I got lucky, Cayla. When I was starting in business, I had a really, successful family member. And she was like a second aunt to me, but she was in real estate and she was super, super successful. And she was actually so successful that she was in Anthony Robbins's infomercial. Okay.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, so her name's Marty Rodriguez, and she's just a super, you know, incredible woman. And she's like one of my heroes, you know, growing up. And so I went to go talk to her and I said, what do you think about this business that I'm doing? And she had already been a client of the company and everything. So she loved it. She told me it was great. She told me that, you know, isn't it crazy how the more successful you are, the more positive and excited you are about helping other people. You know
what I mean? Oh my gosh, yeah.
And then the broke people out there, they're like trying to freaking tear your dreams apart every chance they get, you know? And so I went to go talk to her. She said, this is great. First thing I ever did, like I'm 2 months into the business, 21 years old. And she says, I'm taking you to Anthony Robbins' seminar.
Oh, wow.
And I go to the seminar. We sit like front row. And it's just, this dude rocked it, man. And I've been to probably, you know, I don't know, at least 5 or 6 of his events through the years. Of course, that's cost me tons of money to be able to do those kind of things. And of course, you know, masterminds. And I mean, I've spent tens of thousands, probably $50,000 to $100,000 in personal development through the years in growing a business. And just trying to grow myself. And of course, I'm a consummate reader. I mean, I'm not a great like book reader. Mm-hmm. I like audible.com.
Yeah.
So I'm big on Audible. I mean, I probably do, you know, 2 or 3 books a month or whatever. I'm just always trying to get better. There's not a day that I don't watch a YouTube video. You know, there's not a day that I don't, you know, listen to a podcast or listen to somebody that has something to say. I mean, I learn a lot from Instagram. I get a lot of value that people bring to me through Instagram. I think Instagram is a great self-improvement program if you're following the right people, you know?
Right.
but it's been so, so worth it, to be able to, you know, look at myself today and go, you know what? Ain't perfect. I don't got everything perfect yet. Got still a lot of things for me to work on, but I'm getting better, and I'm proud of me. that I stuck it out, man. And when everybody said I wouldn't make it, when everybody said I wasn't good enough, when everybody said I wasn't smart enough, everybody said I wasn't tall enough. And just kidding. I mean, I'm not very tall, but I always tell people that my company allows short people to make it too. So thank God for that, you know? And I just think it's so worth it to better yourself every day.
It sounds like you're just committed to being a student of life.
That's it.
Right? Oh, and then the more that you learn, the more you realize you don't know. So you're like, I got to learn more.
Yeah, and it's just fun. I mean, it's fun. And like I was out to dinner with Forbes Riley. I don't know if you know Forbes.
Yeah.
And I was out to dinner with her the other night and her boyfriend, Joshua. And this dude looks like freaking Mr. Universe.
Isn't he like running for that? He's like a bodybuilder.
I don't know what he's running for, but man, this dude like looks like we kept calling him Captain America. You know, like this is what he looks like. He's like perfect chiseled, you know, whatever. And so I reach over, you know, I lean over at the dinner and I'm like, dude, you need to tell me how I can, you know, just get better in that area. And I said, because he was asking me some questions I said, man, you teach me that, I'll teach you, you know what I mean? And I just think it's cool because I told him, I said, I only take advice from people that I want what they have.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, if you're not a multi-millionaire, I'm not taking advice from you. I mean, just pure and simple. I mean, that's what I'm looking for, people that I want to. So if somebody has a great physique or great health and stuff like that, I mean, like I want to learn from them. I want to get better all the time. But be careful who you take advice from. And mm-hmm. I just think that's what I think.
That's one of the best pieces of advice that somebody gave me a long time ago. And I love that we're kind of ending it on that note, because you guys, everybody listening in right now, like hopefully you rewind this and listen to it a couple of times and take notes, because success leaves clues, right? And I've just heard it so many times. I'm like, gosh, everything's just gold that he's dropping. So I hope all of you guys realize that. I know I'd trade places with you, Daniel. So I'm taking advice from you. And I think it was too many of us, we take advice from people that are broke and unhappy. People that we would never, like ever want to trade places with, even on that person's best day. We would listen to their advice. We buy into their opinions. And today's the day I think we need to start buying into our own opinions and buying into our reasons why, buy into our list of 150 things that we want to accomplish in our life. And I don't know, I'm fired up after this podcast. So where can everybody find you?
At Daniel Alonzo with a Z at the end. Instagram is the main place. Facebook's getting so complicated. So you can still find me on Facebook, but it's like a million things going on there. And of course, I have a YouTube channel, Daniel Alonzo. And I also have my Wealth on the Beach mm-hmm. podcast, which you were on, and that'll be featured pretty soon. And then, of course, I do a coaching program. It's called Wealth on the Beach Club, where they sign up every Wednesday morning at 9 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. They come on. I give them an hour lesson on how to build massive passive income. Mm-hmm. That's all I think about. I mean, I think most people, they want freedom and choices. And I teach people how to get some freedom and choices and options in their life. And so if anybody's interested, sign up at alonzoacademy.com. Alonzoacademy.com.
Yay. Okay. And we'll link up all of his stuff to the show notes, you guys. So you guys will be able to check that out. And if you guys loved this episode, I want you to do me a favor, because you know this podcast is completely free. I don't take any sponsorships for it whatsoever. But the way that I keep it free is by knowing that you guys are getting value. And so I want you guys to take a screenshot of the podcast episode, write in on there, you know, what you learned today from Daniel, tag Daniel Alonzo, tag Cayla Craft on Instagram, and make sure to do that right away. And we'll repost it, maybe. I don't know, Daniel. I always repost everything because I want to make sure people know to constantly listen in and what they're going to get out of it. And I think that's it for today. But I want to remind you guys too, if you haven't left a review for this podcast, you guys, what the heck have you been doing? I need you to leave a review today. And you guys can just give me 5 stars, write a review. Every single week, I give out a pair of Lorna Jane pants because those are the best workout pants that I love. And we'll be picking a winner on Sunday night and I share it out on my Instagram. So if you do that, you guys can be entered in to win this week. As always, ladies, go out there and get what you want. Thank you for listening to the Mommy Millionaire Podcast. For free resources and materials, head over to mommymillionaire.co. Make sure to follow Mommy Millionaire on Spotify and subscribe on iTunes. And it would mean the world to me if you left a 5-star review of the show. And as always, ladies, go out there and get what you want.